All right. So we're stepping out in faith. As we said earlier, this is our annual spiritually deepening program that we go on together. So every week we will be diving on to the next step in this path to possibility. Every week you'll receive, when you come in, you'll receive, these will be hooked together, cards. And you'll sign one, which is our commitment card, to step out in faith for this particular week. And then you'll take the affirmation card home to work with during the course of the week. And then remember that on Wednesday nights here, Veronica Baez will be doing a deeper dive into the path to possibilities with a program that's been written by our practitioners in conjunction with what we're doing together as a community. So our step out in faith, our path to possibilities. And so it begins with setting a direction. We have to decide if we are going to be on a journey, right? Where our topic for this month is, or for this year, is loving the journey. And we want to decide where we want to go. And so often it feels like we ask, does anybody know which way I should be going? Wouldn't you just like a sign? I mean, I often think of like a neon, bright, flashing arrow. That, you know, I don't think that would be too hard for God to do, don't you think? Yeah. Does anybody know which way I should be going? And so we have to decide where we're headed.
Now let's see. Where was I? I wonder which way I ought to go.
Bell in the way.
Why, you're a cat.
A Cheshire cat. All a mimsy. Oh, where the border goes.
Oh, wait. Don't go, please.
There you are. Third course.
Oh, no. Thank you, but I just wanted to ask you which way I ought to go.
Well, that depends on where you want to get to.
Oh, it really doesn't matter. As long as I can...
Then it really doesn't matter which way you go. Oh, by the way, if you'd really like to know, he went that way.
Question, right? This is the question that he asks. Where do you want to end up? It doesn't matter where you go. It matters if, well, let me rephrase that. So often we spend all of our time trying to figure out where we want to go, and we get very involved in figuring out what we need to do next and next and next and next, and we have not yet determined where we actually want to end up. And so we actually have to decide, when we are setting our direction, when we're moving out onto this path of possibilities, where is it that we want to end up? And so often when we decide we're going to move into something new in our lives, or we want to have a different experience, or we want to change a job or a career, or have life be different, so often what happens is that we begin to become very concerned about its form, what it looks like. Well, I don't even want to say what it looks like. We actually are much more concerned about the shape and definition of it. So I'm going to get a career. Okay, so am I going to be an accountant? Am I going to be a doctor? Am I going to make $20 an hour? Am I going to make $100,000 an hour? $100,000 a year? What am I going to... We begin to become very invested in the form that it takes. Yeah. And we forget that the form isn't what brings us joy and happiness. Right? It is the quality of our life experience that brings us joy and happiness. It's the quality of our life experience that is really where we want to end up. I can't imagine any of us saying, I want to end up the rest of my life working in a cubicle, answering the phones, making X amount of money. I'm guessing that you probably could say, I want to end up my life feeling like I made a difference, feeling like my life mattered to somebody, feeling like I had love in my life, like I contributed, like my life had meaning and purpose. Do you see, that's the way that we explore our life in terms of the quality of life experience. Then the form is a whole lot less important, because actually we could have the experience of love in our life, or the experience of giving of ourselves, of making a contribution. You see, we can have that experience in lots and lots of different forms, lots of different ways that can show up. So the first thing we want to think about is, where do we want to end up, and how are we describing where we want to end up? Are we describing it in terms of these narrow boxes of form, or are we describing it as the kind of life experience that we want to have? Because, of course, each one of us is here to express ourselves. We're here to be the divine, the incarnation of life itself, the one, expressing and experiencing life as us, not as some little box, some little form or definition that we have about how life should be, or how we'd like to be able to describe it, but actually the experience that we want to have. Where do you want to end up? And then the question is, where do you want to end up? Not where does your mother think you should end up. Not how did your father groom you to end up. Not what do you think society requires of you, but where do you want to end up? You see, one of the most powerful, unique, and wonderful things it is about being a spiritual being, having a human experience, is that we have this God-given opportunity, and it's called choosing. No one can do it for us. We actually have to choose. We have to decide where we want to end up. Otherwise, we end up by default wherever the particular path is going that somebody set us on, or that we stumbled upon in some way. We haven't actually chosen where we want to end up. As the Cheshire Cat says, if you don't care where you want to end up, then it doesn't matter what path you take. It doesn't matter which road you walk or what thing you start looking toward. So where do we want to end up? What does this life look like that we want to have? And we might have lots of that already. We might have many parts of our life that already look like, feel like, we experience them the way that we want. And then there may be parts of our life where that's not the case. And so as we step out on this path to possibility, we want to think about those areas in our life where perhaps we want to experience something new or different. And how do we do that? How do we experience something new, something different than what we have been experiencing in the past? So basically, the question is, how do you get on a new path? How do you find a new road? Rather than simply walking the one that you find yourself on, or feeling like you have to stay stuck in that particular path, how do we find a new one? Well, in the science of mind, and in lots of different kinds of psychologies, and lots of different ways in which we can look at life, there is this notion that we actually narrate our life into being. We actually experience the life that we tell the story about. The way in which we tell the story about our life is actually what gives us direction and provides us the path. So I want to read to you from this fabulous little book called The Art of Possibility. And they write this: our minds are designed to string events together into storylines, whether or not there is any connection between the parts. In dreams, we regularly weave sensations gathered from disparate parts of our lives into narratives. In full wakefulness, we produce reasons for our actions that are rational, plausible, and guided by the logic of cause and effect, whether or not these reasons actually portray any of the real motivational forces behind it. Experiments with people who have suffered a lesion between the two halves of their brain have shown that when the right side is prompted, say, to close a door, the left side, unaware of the experimenter's instructions, will produce a reason as to why he has just closed the door, such as, oh, I felt a draft. Yeah, it's interesting to think about, isn't it? In full wakefulness, we produce reasons for our actions that are rational, plausible, and guided by the logic of cause and effect, whether or not that actually exists. So we are constantly narrating our story into being. Now, I can tell you this, so let me give you an example. I can tell you the story of my life. I grew up in Philadelphia, in upper middle class Philadelphia, out on the main line. Lots and lots and lots of my friends grew up in mansions, and we belonged to the country club, and I got swim lessons, and dance lessons, and ballet lessons, and piano lessons, and all the lessons that a little girl's heart could actually ever want. I traveled to Europe two or three times. Every two or three years, we would spend all summer in Ocean City, New Jersey, when my dad would just come visit from work. I was gifted a trip around the world for my 16th birthday. I graduated from high school a year early. I went on to college and have been reasonably successful in everything that I've ever attempted. Isn't that a great story? I love that story, right? That's the story of my life. So I can tell you the story of my life. The story of my life is that I was raised by German immigrants. German is my native language. It's actually my first language. My father is an alcoholic, rageaholic, who regularly abused his family. I followed right in his footsteps with alcohol and drugs. I was taken out of a regular high school and put into an alternative high school so that I would actually survive my high school years. And I went on to college and made it through my first year in college, became suicidally depressed, was absolutely abusing drugs and alcohol. That's what drove me into a Science of Mind community, into the first Center for Spiritual Living I found in Seattle. My life has been a series of healings around that, from all of that experience of my childhood. Two entirely different stories, both of them equally true. And I can tell you that there were a number of years in my life, in my 20s, and especially in my 20s and late 20s, where I lived on the second story. What a wounded person I was. How could anybody expect my life to be any different? Because, well, I'm a product of my childhood, a product of an alcoholic family. Of course I have alcohol. Of course I have addictive tendencies. What a struggle it is, what a challenge it is. I have to keep healing myself. I have to keep pulling the layers of the onion away, and I'll never, never, ever, ever get away from the fact that these things are true about my life. That was the story I told. Until I decided I didn't like that story anymore. Because I shouldn't like how it was playing out in my life. Because the more I kept telling the story about how wounded I was and how my past was the predicator of my future, that's the path I was on. Coming into the Science of Mind, learning that I could actually change my story about life, that I could tell a different story, that I'm a spiritual being, that my life is whole, perfect, and complete in every way, and that every opportunity is a learning for me. Do you see how that completely changes the way in which we experience our own story? And what I noticed is that in telling the story about my alcoholic father and the abuse and the woundedness and whatever, then that's exactly what I attracted and experienced in life. That's all I saw. Because that was the filter through which I was experiencing life. And so my brain would begin to create logical cause and effect relationships with all of these other things that were going on and only pick out those things that would support that story. You see, that's how we operate. That's what we're all constantly doing. So, but the thing to notice is that there are two completely different stories I can tell. both of them true. I get to choose which one I'm going to speak about. You get to choose the story you're going to tell about your life, the story you're going to tell about yourself. So in this wonderful book, the first thing they talk about is it's all invented. Everything is invented. This story, not the facts, but all the assumptions and all of the ways in which we have come to tell our story. We've actually invented the narrative. We've picked out this and this and this and this and this and strung them together and said, that's the narrative of my life. I could pick out different things, and I would invent a different story. So how do you discover the story you're telling? You ask this first set of questions. This first set of questions is how you discover the story you're telling. What assumption am I making that I am not aware that I am making that gives me what I see? What assumption am I making that I am not aware that I am making that gives me what I see? Do you see? What assumption is providing me with the filter through which we're looking at life? And we can begin to hear these assumptions if we will pay attention to the way we tell the story. So I'm going to tell you a story. Some of you have heard this story from my life. It's actually one of my favorite stories. This is from years ago. A friend of mine and I went to Scotland, and we went on the Whiskey Trail, and we had a great time, and we ended up in the Isle of Skye, and we ended up in this little place and had many, many, many bed and breakfasts and only four restaurants. So you had to wait for a really long time to have a place, to get a place to eat. You had to wait and wait and wait, and all the little places to eat were really small. It was not very well organized by the tourist bureau, I will tell you that. So anyway, one night we decided, okay, we're really going to brave the wait. We waited for almost an hour and a half, and we got our little seat. We got our little table in the corner of the restaurant. I don't know, there were maybe 10 or 12 other tables. There was a little table, and then there was this little space, and then there was another little table right next to us. And we were over here, and we finally got seated, and we went through the menu. Don't let anybody tell you that the food in England and Scotland is bad, because it's not true. They have some of the best seafood in the world, particularly up in the north there. So I found this fabulous seafood platter. Oh my gosh, and it had shrimp on it, and it had fish on it, and it had all of these wonderful things on it, not fried. And the best part of it was right at the top was this big thing of langoustine. Now, if you don't know what langoustine is, it's kind of a cross between a shrimp and a lobster. It's only from the only from the very far north and the very cold, cold, cold. And it is the sweetest, most succulent seafood you ever want to eat on your plate. So I saw that and I said, ooh, I'm having that. And sure enough, it came. It was this massive platter. It was beautifully presented. And I was, I was all enthralled with it. And by that time, our neighbors had sat down, a couple from Switzerland. We exchanged a few words in German. They couldn't really speak any English. They were perusing the menu, and I was beginning to enjoy my seafood. Actually, I was really enjoying my seafood. Actually, the truth is I was having one of those Harry Met Sally moments right there in the restaurant. It was true, I was, and I actually wasn't really noticing that I was having that, but apparently the whole restaurant was. Actually, so much so that the lady was sitting next to me, who was Swiss, who couldn't speak any English, and she wasn't really sure what was on the menu. She said to the waitress, I'll have it, she said. And wouldn't that be a great place to end the story? Isn't that a fabulous story? It's one of my favorite stories of my whole life. Okay, but what I noticed not too long ago is that I came home and I would tell that story, but there's actually a little coda to the end of the story that I insisted on putting on every time. And the coda of that story is, and the woman from Switzerland who started to eat with relish the langoustine discovered that she didn't like it. And I couldn't get out of the restaurant fast enough. I was so embarrassed. And I noticed that when I told that story, it was important for me to say out loud that that person didn't like what I had eaten, as if somehow I had done something wrong. Isn't that interesting? And how uncomfortable it made me that someone had followed in my footsteps, even though I had not in any way, shape, or form encouraged her to do so, that I was extremely uncomfortable with that. And by exploring the way that I told that story and exploring the fact that I kept having to add this little coda to it, I began to discover that there was a place in myself where I was uncomfortable with having people follow me. I was uncomfortable with being a leader. Because what if I led them in the wrong direction? What if they didn't like it? So it would be much better if people didn't follow me. It's a hard assumption to have when you're the senior minister. It doesn't really work very well. But I didn't know it until I began to hear this particular story that I was telling and how I was narrating my life. Do you see? And as I began to recognize that and say, wait, I'm not telling anybody what they have to do. I'm not saying you have to get this plate of food. You have to do these things. I'm having a life experience and I'm sharing it with people. And they can do what they, you know, I began to really become more and more and more comfortable with myself as a leader and with myself in what I'm doing with my life. And what I noticed is I no longer have to tell that coda to the story. The story is so much more fun if I can just end it with her saying, I'll have what she has. And it's just as true. Do you see? So we can begin to experience and discover how we are inventing our lives by paying attention to the way in which we tell the stories, the way in which we narrate our life. We will begin to hear the assumptions that we're making. So what do we do now? What do we do now about any particular part of our life that we want to have be different? How do we invent it? How do we invent it into something new? And so here's the second set of questions that they give us in The Art of Possibility. What might I now invent that I haven't yet invented that would give me other choices? Right? Because remember we said we have the power to choose. This opening, this idea that we are inventing our life, begins to open us up to new possibilities. Now, not that every possibility we're going to dream of is one we're going to follow through on, but we'll never find a different road if we can't at least explore some other options, right? We're never going to find a new path if we don't look at some other places that we want to end up. So what might I now invent that I haven't yet invented that would give me other choices? So another example of this from our life here in this community, when we were still in the old space, excuse me, where we used to be down on Alpha and Midway, not too far from here, we were a much smaller community. Actually, we had 20 people when I came here 12 years ago, and we had grown to about 40, and then we sort of made this leap to 80. It was all very exciting, and then we hovered there for quite a while, and we kept running up to 100, and then we'd drop back to 80, and then we'd run back up to 100, and we'd drop back to 80. Being in this place with as a community was really stretching our resources. It was stretching our ability to do what we said we were going to do because of the way we had organized ourselves. And we kept running up to what felt like limitations about how we were operating, and we kept thinking, well, gosh, you know, how do we expand and grow? And so I remember at the time we had this conversation at our core council, and the conversation began to be about, well, what if we stopped talking about ourselves as a small church? What if we simply began asking the question, well, how would we do this if we were a big church? How would we engage in this question if we were a big church? How would we move in this direction if we were moving on our way to being a big church? Because you see, we had done nothing but talk about, well, as a small church, you know, we can't do this. Well, as a small church, you know, we just can't do that. Well, as a small church, you know, these are the limitations that we have. You see, that was the story we were telling. We were telling the story of ourselves as a small church. And that was the delimiting factor that we were experiencing. So we simply invented a new story. We invented the story that we were becoming a big church. We were becoming a big church. And the questions that we asked ourselves were all within the context of what would it like to be a big church? How would we do this if we were a big church? And do you see, we began to open up the possibilities of seeing it differently. Not that we necessarily went right out and behaved like a big church, but the possibilities began to open up for us. We simply invented a new story about it. Because it's all invented anyway, right? It's all made up. We are completely free to choose. We're free to choose our life. We're free to choose whatever we focus on. We're free to choose the experiences that we want to catalog in our minds. We're free to have ourselves be completely limited by those things, or we are free to imagine something new. So as we experience and really get that it's all invented, we begin to ask ourselves, what might I now invent that I haven't yet invented that would give me other choices? What might you do? What might you invent in your own life? Now, here is a very important piece of information. There is no right answer. There is no right answer to this question. There really isn't. I can't tell you how many times I have this conversation with people who come to me with counseling. Should I stay in this relationship or should I go? Should I stay in this job or should I leave? Should I take this job or should I take that job? What should I do? Should I follow my dream to become an artist? Should I follow my dream to become a parent? Should I follow my dream to make a lot of money? Should I follow my spiritual dream? What should I do? There is no right answer. There's only your answer. There's only your answer. It's however God is seeking to express itself as you in this particular moment. There's no right answer. We get to choose. We get to decide. And we're sometimes so busy trying to figure out what's the right answer, what's the most spiritual thing to do, what's the most logical and clear thing to do, what's the thing that, you know, what's the thing my mother would have wanted me to do? You know, whatever it is, what's the path my father has set for me? What did I decide 10 years ago? Whatever it is. We're so busy trying to figure out what the right answer is, or the best answer. The truth is, we will learn and grow and discover no matter what answer we make. Take the job, you'll learn and grow. Don't take the job, you will learn and grow. Be in that relationship, you will learn and grow and express yourself. Don't be in that relationship, you will learn and grow and express yourself. Do you see? In that sense, there's no right answer. There's only your answer at the moment. What makes your heart sing? What feels like it will fulfill you? What provides the greatest contribution? Again, not the form, not the box. Oh, I should make this much money. Oh, I should have this job title. Oh, I should live in this kind of a house. Oh, I should have... Do you see what I'm saying? Not the form, but the quality of life experience. That's the answer. Now, how do we find that? I love this portion of this book called The Art of Possibilities. They talk about this thing called a world of measurement. We live in the world of measurement. The world of measurement is this world where the goal is to survive in a world of scarcity and peril. And that's not my fun. You want to sign up for that? Yeah. Well, unfortunately, most of us are living in it. Let me read you what they talk about, the world of measurement. All the manifestations of the world of measurement, the winning and losing, the gaining of acceptance and the threatened rejection, The raised hopes and the dash into despair all are based on a single assumption that is hidden from our awareness. The assumption is that life is about staying alive and making it through. How many of us have found ourselves, well, if I can just make it through, if I can just make it through, if I can just survive this. The assumption is that life is about staying alive and making it through, surviving in a world of scarcity and peril. Certain responses are better suited than others to an environment where survival is the issue, all of which are prevalent in the world of measurement. Alertness to danger, a clever strategic mind, an eye for assessing friend or foe, a knack for judging strength and weaknesses, the know-how to take possession of resources, a measure of mistrust, and a good dollop of fear are some of the qualities that will safeguard us. Keeping our armor intact is of critical importance as well, which means resisting any challenge to our personal viewpoint. This is the world of measurement. The opinionated little voice in the head that so many of us have is almost always speaking from measurement central. Life in the measurement world seems to be arranged in hierarchies. Some groups, peoples, bodies, places, and ideas seem better or more powerful than others. Lines appear, dividing an inside from an outside. Some people, races, ethnicities, organizations, way of doing things are safer or more desirable to belong to than others. There are only so many pieces of the pie. The dramatic action of this world of success and failure has to do with overcoming odds and prevailing, or being acknowledged and included. Living in a world of scarcity and peril, where our goal is to survive. And these are the things that we talk about. These are the ways in which we know that we are living in the world of measurement. When we're wondering whether we or other people or the situation measures up to something, whether we're on the inside or the outside, whether they're on the inside or the outside, whether there's never enough, and all the comparisons that we do with ourselves and each other, and that there's a right way and a wrong way, all of these come from that survival part of us that believes that we live in a world of scarcity and peril. Now, survival thinking is not the same thing as actually having real scarcity in our lives. If we really don't have food on our table, and we don't have electricity turned on, and we don't have the things that are required, we may be living in an actual world of scarcity. 90% of us here in this room and in the United States don't. We live in survival thinking, which is this assumption that the whole point is to get through and to survive somehow. But as spiritual beings having a human experience, we actually know we have eternity. We have all of eternity to express ourselves, experience who we are, to love and to give and to share. And so this moment in time is an opportunity for learning and growth. It's an opportunity to contribute, to be ourselves, to give of who we are. But it's okay if we make a mistake. It's okay if it doesn't work out. It's okay if it's not perfect or isn't right. Because from the universal point of view, surviving and getting through isn't the measurement. So if we can move from a world of measurement, we move into a universe of possibility. The universe of possibility is generative and giving. It's about creating ideas and meaning and value. It's about contributions and purpose. It's about context and life experience. It's about knowing that life is unfolding and that we're here to love and to share. Can you just feel how different these words feel than comparing and measuring up and setting the standard and having the goal and the... This is about creation and generating and giving and loving and being and experience and exploring and all of those kinds of things. And so our universe of possibility, do you see, it opens all of this up for us. Not that we're necessarily going to take every possibility that we dream of, or that we're going to follow through on everything that we invent. But until we are willing to have the possibilities and the inventions, we're stuck with our narrow little road that we found ourselves on, maybe not quite sure why. The universe of possibilities is generative and giving. They write this: in the realm of possibilities, we gain our knowledge by invention. Now here, this is straight science mind. Listen to this. We decide that the essence of a child is joy, and joy she is. Our small business attracts the label, the can-do company, and that is exactly who we are. We speak with the awareness that language creates categories of meaning that open up new worlds to explore. Life appears as variety, pattern, and shimmering movement. And if you take a slice, the pie is whole again. In the universe of possibilities, there's enough. There's enough and more than enough. It's up to us. It's up to us to decide. So here is the final question. If we want to set our direction, if we want to move out onto the path of possibilities, if we want to explore what we might invent, we want to explore what's out there that we might have different in our lives, if we want to explore the meaning and purpose and value that we want to give and contribute, here is the question. Are you ready? The question is, what do you want? And I'm guessing it's not a title, it's not a corner office, it's not a particular house or a particular car, it's probably not any particular form at all. If we can really express what it is that we want to have meaning in our life, there are so many ways that we can invent having meaning. We want to contribute. Let's invent all of the ways in which you can contribute. You can contribute to your children, to your parents, to your family. You can contribute at work by how you answer the phone, how you can contribute to your boss, your employees, your employers. You can contribute to your clients, to your customers. You can contribute to this community. You can contribute to the world at large. Do you see how many ways we can invent that you contribute, that your life has meaning and purpose, that you can experience and express the life of your dreams? All we have to do is open up to the possibilities. So I invite you this week to ask yourself the question, what do you want? And think about it from the context of it's all invented. You can invent anything that you want, and that it's all about the possibilities that are open to us. So step out in faith together by practicing this week. So if you would get your little cards out, you'll notice that you have a commitment card and an affirmation card. So what we're going to ask you to do is to commit to stepping out in faith with us. So you're going to sign this little commitment card called Setting a Direction. The ushers are coming around with cards if you don't have one, or with pens if you need one. And so if you would look at your Setting the Direction card with me, let's read this Setting Direction together. Today, I commit to step out in faith on my own path to possibility. I join with my spiritual community in exploring the infinite possibilities available to me right now. Every day, I commit to thinking outside my own box and imagining one new thing I haven't imagined before. All right, and so if the band would come on up here and join us. So if you are willing to commit, to make this commitment to step out in faith this way with us this week, please sign it and date it. You're going to drop it off in the offering basket as it goes by. and we'll be sharing the names of our community members, of everyone who is stepping out in faith with us week after week, until we get to the sixth week. And please remember that you can come on Wednesday nights to go a little more deeply into this process. While you're finishing filling out your cards and the ushers are making sure that you have one, I do want to remind you that the book, The Art of Possibilities, is our book for the month. We have sold out in the bookstore, but she is taking prepaid orders and will make a new order on Monday morning, so we'll have it here this week. All right, does it feel like we're getting everybody's... Okay, and then remember, you're going to sign the commitment card, and you're going to keep the affirmation card to work with during the week. All right. So we're going to close together by singing the Alleluia.